If you're starting a nonprofit, where do you even begin to start raising money? What actions do you need to take to successfully lay the groundwork to start fundraising or get your first donation? In this video, I'll talk you through the process step by step. My name is Amber Melanie Smith, and I make these videos here on YouTube to help aspiring change makers with tips and strategies to help you change the world and live a life of impact and purpose. I hope this video helps you out today. Don't forget to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel for more videos on social change, social impact, nonprofits, and more. As I've shared in other videos, many years ago, I started a nonprofit organization, and it's now my full-time career. Figuring out how to raise money was a long journey filled with mistakes and challenges and some victories too, but a lot of learning. So in this video, I'm hoping to save you a little time and talk through the very beginning steps, step by step, to help you hopefully get past some of the setbacks that are easy to fall into when you're just getting started. Now, this video is specifically designed for those just getting started in the nonprofit world and with fundraising. These instructions will give you a simple playbook to just get the basics right and get your feet on the ground. Now, before I get into the steps, please understand that there are many, many ways to raise money for nonprofit organizations. But in this specific video, I will be talking about raising money from individual donors. Now, I talk about some of the other ways to raise money in other videos and will continue to talk about those ways in future videos as well. But knowing how to raise money and setting yourself up for success with individual donors is very important because individual donors are one of the top ways nonprofits can generate sustainable income that they can count on. All right, so let's get into the steps. Step one, plan your strategy for your whole nonprofit and your fundraising in advance. Ideally, before you even think about launching a nonprofit, you want to be considering how are you going to keep it financially sustainable and design your programs to make them as impactful as possible. So you're going to want to have your business plan in place before you get started, which will include your ideas on how you're going to generate funds for your nonprofit. And it is a good idea for most beginning nonprofits to have a diverse income stream. So planning out how you're going to raise money through a variety of means, such as events, grants, corporate sponsorships, and the subject of this video, individual donations. If you're interested in learning the basics of some of those other ways to raise money, check out my other video here on my YouTube channel called How Successful Nonprofits Raise Money When Starting or Growing. When you're talking about getting individual donations, there are four main types of individual donations. The first type is a one-time donation. This could be anywhere from $5 to $500 or any other amount. This is just your one-time donation. Someone comes by, they love what you do, they drop you a few dollars, and you might not hear from them again, or if you play your cards right, you might hear from them again. Which brings me to the second type of individual donation, which is a recurring donation. This is when a donor decides that they're going to help keep you afloat by donating regularly, usually something like once a month or quarterly. Recurring donations are awesome, and you really want to be trying to get these recurring donations because it means that you know and can predict that donations will be coming in month to month, which allows you to budget and spend the money accordingly. The third type of donation from an individual is through a donor-advised fund. This is when a donor wants some assistance in divvying out their donations, so they will put their funds that they want to donate into a donor-advised fund, possibly with a community foundation or other type of foundation, and then that foundation helps them make decisions about where the money goes. They also will actually administer the donations, so instead of that donor having to write the check and follow up and all of that, the foundation will take care of that for them. If you want access to donor-advised funds, it's a good idea to introduce yourself and your nonprofit to a community foundation in your area, make sure that they are aware of you and what you do, so that if they think of a donor who might be a good fit for what your mission is, they can recommend them to you. The fourth type of individual donation is called a major gift. A major gift is a large, substantial donation to your cause. So what makes a donation big enough to have it count as a major gift? It's kind of relative. Honestly, a major gift is whatever feels major to your organization at that time and at the size you're at the moment. If you're a pretty small or new organization, $1,000 might be the biggest donation size you've ever seen, and that could be counted as a major gift right there. On the other side, for a major institution like, for example, a university or a big museum, a major gift might be millions of dollars. It all depends on what would constitute a substantial donation to your cause. Getting a major gift from a donor can take a while because it's important to build up a relationship with someone before you can actually ask them to support you with a major gift, which makes total sense. You probably wouldn't give someone you don't know and don't have a relationship with a large chunk of money randomly. Now that you know about four common types of individual donations, you can start thinking about how they might play a role in your business plan that you're developing for step one. Step two is simply get your paperwork in order. If you're at the beginning and you haven't gotten through the paperwork to file for your legal tax-exempt status as a public charity, you're going to want to do that before you can accept donations. Now, technically, in some states, you can start accepting tax-deductible donations before you get your IRS tax-exempt status if you are incorporated in your state as a nonprofit entity, but you still have to go ahead and get your federal tax-exempt status for that to count for the long haul. The state incorporation is just meant to be a temporary measure and a show of good faith to donors that you intend to finish up the paperwork and get your tax-exempt status from the federal government very soon. So don't forget, paperwork is not just when you're getting started as a nonprofit. In many states, your state will require you to file for a charitable solicitation license every year and keep that renewed in order to have the permission to actually solicit for donations. It's basically a license for your nonprofit that allows your nonprofit to ask people for money. Step three is just to have the rest of your basics down. You've got to have your clear mission statement, your vision statement, your plan for how you're actually going to run your programs to meet your mission statement, and your goals for the next future period, whether it's a year or 3 years. If someone is going to donate money to you, they're going to want to know that you've got a plan. I talk to so many people who want to start a nonprofit but haven't thought through these steps, and that'll mean that donors aren't going to feel confident giving to your cause because they don't know what you're going to do with their funding and how you're actually going to make good on the promise you've made to improve the community. Step four is to make sure you've got a website ready to attract donations. For attracting and inspiring donors, you really want to have a website that makes donating easy for them. You want to make sure that you've got that donate button very clear on your website homepage, as well as multiple other locations throughout your website. And make sure all of your donation pages are easy to use and navigate. There's nothing worse than wanting to help a cause, going on their website to try to figure out how to give them money, and then having an incredibly frustrating experience trying to figure out where the button is, or how to use the button, or how to fill in a form, or how to make it work. You gotta have your technology in place. You wanna have a user-friendly payment processing system built into your site. My nonprofit uses Stripe, for example. Do keep in mind that the majority of payment processing systems do charge a small transaction fee for each donation. It's pretty inevitable. Just be upfront and transparent with your donors about that. Some donors will even opt to help you cover that transaction fee by adding a couple of cents or a couple of dollars to their donation too. A couple more tips about that donation button. You want to make sure that your donation button itself is bold, clear, and a noticeable color. There's actually a lot of interesting research out there on color psychology and what colors inspire people to give more money. Some people say that a green button makes people think of money and that inspires them to give. Others say that blue is a really popular choice by most people and that it inspires trust. Ultimately, go with your gut on the color, but also make sure that your donation buttons and your whole website actually matches your donations or your nonprofit's logo and branding. Another tip is it would probably be a good idea to include a beautiful, inspiring, high-quality photo somewhere near your donation button. And you want it to be an image of something related to your cause that also has an emotional impact. This is why a lot of nonprofits have adorable pictures of puppies or kids near their donation buttons, because they know how that works. Step five is to get your fundraising message ready. Asking for donations can happen in a variety of places, in a variety of ways, letter, email, text on your website, but ultimately you want to have this messaging on point and ready to go before you begin asking for money. And you really want it to include the compelling reasons why someone should donate to your cause in the first place. There are a lot of causes out there that need help. Why should they pick yours? You got to explain it in clear, impactful terms. So here are some things you're going to want to include in your fundraising messaging, and you can use this stuff on your website and your emails and your future letters, wherever. But all of these elements are really important to have in your fundraising message somewhere. For new organizations especially, but generally all organizations, you want to show some kind of proof of concept. Basically, what this means is evidence that your programs have worked or likelihood that they will work if you're new. So for new nonprofits, you can do this in a couple of ways. Since you probably haven't had a lot of time to show the evidence that your programs will work, you can show a couple of stories or stats about the people you have been able to help so far, or the evidence and data that shows or indicates that your idea is likely to work. But not too many stats. Nobody likes reading a page of stats. Donors like knowing that they are investing in something that is proven to make an impact. So you might do this by laying out the problem your nonprofit is trying to solve and then explaining your proposed solution. Maybe something like this. Did you know that 1 in 4 teens experience depression or anxiety? Research shows that having access to a safe place where they can talk about their feelings can help because of X, Y, and Z. The second thing you want to always include in your fundraising messaging is a personal story. This is the story of how someone's life has been changed by your work or could be changed. People have a hard time wrapping their brains around just statistics and data, so you've got to pair them with a compelling personal story. It's a lot easier to identify with a single subject that you're trying to help as a donor. And of course, always use images if possible, if you can do so in a non-exploitative manner. Be sure to always get permission from anyone that you are taking photographs of to share on your materials and your site, and also avoid taking advantage of people's vulnerabilities and their bad situations by photographing them and trying to compel people to support you through those negative images. In the nonprofit world, we're always walking a line between trying to inspire people and show them the problems in the world and ultimately respecting those people who are affected by those problems. It's a critical component of this work. In your fundraising messaging, you also want to try to include a little bit about you and your story. Who are you? Why is this nonprofit so important to you? How has this cause impacted your life? Inquiring donors want to know. Ultimately, people want to donate to causes who are led by humans that they trust and have a relationship with and can empathize with. So sharing parts of your personal story can help build that trust and relationship. And finally, probably the most important part of a fundraising message is the call to action. Imagine if you spent all that time laying out some wonderful research and your beautiful, compelling stories and then forgot to actually ask for money. So in this case, your call to action at the end of your fundraising message is to donate to your cause. Make it simple and straightforward, like, donate now to help us launch this program this fall. Step 6. It's time to start finding and attracting your first donors. This might seem like the hardest, most mysterious part, but it's actually not. There are places to find potential donors everywhere. However, please understand that donors rarely magically appear out of nowhere. Typically, you have to have established some kind of relationship with them in the beginning. And that's because, as I said before, people rarely donate to causes that are complete strangers to them. Now, of course, there are exceptions, like if a particular cause or issue is making headlines and inspiring some urgent action, like a natural disaster or our recent anti-racism protests. In which case, those causes might get a wave of support, even from strangers, while the spotlight's on them. But those situations typically apply to national movements that have a lot of media attention and usually don't relate to the normal city or local nonprofit that you are likely to be a part of. So where do nonprofits typically find their first donors? Because your first donors are likely to be people who have some kind of relationship with you, you can start with your own personal networks, your friends and your family. Beyond your immediate connections, you want to start building up a community and an audience for your nonprofit. This is a marketing concept. The more people who can find you can get to know about you, and then you can build a relationship with them and they can become donors. You can do this in a number of ways. You can start building up your social media. You can start a newsletter to keep people who are interested in your cause informed. You can work with the media to get attention for your nonprofit and your cause by sending out press releases. And one of my favorite ways is public speaking. Arrange presentations with local groups and businesses and clubs. And when you are talking to these people in your public speaking engagements, you want to remind them of those calls to action. Let them know that donations and volunteers and other types of support are needed. Get them to follow you on social media, to subscribe to your newsletter, or to come join you at a special event. Your goal should be to always find some way to engage people on some level, even if it's just a superficial level at first, to allow you to deepen that relationship later. Once you're able to start collecting contact information from people, like an email, then you can start sending them information about the wonderful impacts that you're making as a nonprofit. These will definitely inspire people to give. People really are drawn to the impacts that they can make with their donations, and knowing that you are trying to be transparent and accountable about what you're succeeding at as an organization will inspire that trust and future giving. Once you've built up an audience, it's time to start launching your first fundraising campaign. This should be an email or some kind of communication that invites the people who are subscribed to you, your audience, to contribute to something specific that has an urgent timeline. State your fundraising goal and the reason why you are raising money. For example, donate $20 towards our goal of $1,000 to help us build a ramp for this veteran. Oh, and by the way, we're trying to do this by next month. So you want to be specific with your dollar amount, the purpose for your fundraising, and like I said, you want to put a deadline on it to create a sense of urgency so people will give now. As your campaign is going on and you're inching towards your goal, share that with your audience too. We've raised $700 so far. We're only $300 from our goal. There's nothing like helping an organization or a cause get to that finishing line that excites a donor. Step 7 is super important, and it is to decide how you're going to maintain a relationship with your donors and acknowledge them once they do give. Plan your donor thank you strategy out in advance. Map out a plan to stay in contact with your donors throughout the year. You don't want to be like that relative who only shows up now and then when they need a couple dollars to borrow from you. So get your thank you notes ready and think of other ways you can engage donors throughout the year. Here are a couple of ideas. Invite donors to have coffee with you at some point. Make friends. Invite your donors to a special event with your cause. Reach out at random and send a kind note with a wonderful, beautiful message of well-being. Just because. Not to ask for money. Try hosting a town hall once a year or more often. This is actually something I'm doing with my nonprofit right now, and because of the pandemic, of course, we're doing it over Zoom, but you could do it virtually or in person. So in a town hall, people are invited to come join me for just a casual discussion on everything going on with my nonprofit behind the scenes, and it allows them to ask me any questions they have on their mind, and I can answer them. It makes people feel like they are a part of the cause and the inner workings of what we're trying to accomplish as an organization. And the final step, step 8, is the most critical step of all, and that is to actually thank your donors once they give. And you want to do so in a personal way. Research shows that donors have 2 top ways they prefer to be acknowledged after they give. The first is to share the impact that their donation will make. For example, because of your $50, we will be able to feed 20 kids this month. Or to a personalized note of thanks, typically actually a handwritten note. This should be from the person with whom that donor has a relationship at your organization, whether it's you, the founder or leader of the organization, or whoever did the fundraising campaign. If you skip this step, you will lose donors. You've got to stay in contact with your donors, keep building your audience, share your impacts and the stories of the wonderful work that you are doing regularly. That's all I got. Thanks so much. I really hope this was helpful in helping you lay the groundwork to start getting donations and fundraising for your organization. I'd love to know, what step are you on right now? Where are you in this process? What challenges are you facing right now? Share in the comments below. I really hope you liked this video. Don't forget to give it a thumbs up, like, ring that bell to get alerts about my next videos, and subscribe and keep checking back because I make these videos here on YouTube about nonprofits, social change, social impact, service, and more regularly. Once again, I'm Amber Melanie Smith. Hope to see you soon. Thanks.